Good morning. It is a pleasure to be here with you today. You know, we've got a number of visitors here, and that is always exciting. What a blessing, but you know, to see family again. I like being here. You know, I like being with you guys, so it's just a pleasure to be here. You know, I want to make a point. As a matter of fact, we're going to talk about it in today's passage. We'll kind of brush on it. We're going to talk more in depth in an upcoming week. But, you know, Scripture tells us that we are to be a people of thanksgiving. And so I would like to take the opportunity to say thank you to people that commit time to helping our church function the way that it should. And this week, Jason. Wave your hand, Jason, so everybody can see. Jason came down and helped us. Christy and I were behind on some things, and we wanted to get the bathroom painted before the vinyl came for the floor, and we couldn't quite make everything work. And so I called Jason, and he volunteered to come down and got our bathroom painted for us. So I wanted to say thank you very much, Jason, for being willing to do that for us. As a pastor, it is a huge blessing to me to have so many different people I can call on to help out at the church. And, you know, we have one of the most giving churches that I've ever been a part of. I mean, not just financially, although you guys are fantastic when it comes to giving. But of your time, your energy, your resources, it's just a tremendous blessing. So thank you to all of you. We're going to continue today with our testify. And today I've asked Christopher. Now, you guys are going to think it's weird that there's so many band notes that come up and give their testimonies. But you got to understand that they make up almost a fifth of the entire population of this community church. So one in five is going to end up being a band note. So I've asked Christopher if he would come up and share with us today.
I'm going to hide behind the pillow. Helps my self-esteem. I actually kind of have an advantage because Kevin asked me to give my testimony at the youth group a couple weeks ago. I actually met him once now. So I actually got to sit down and actually coherently type out my thoughts and everything. And it was kind of really the first time I ever sat down and thought about my life and from the beginning to now and how really how God has affected me and how everything he's done for me in my life with him. You know, I kind of have it's not really a favorite verse, but it's a verse that kind of holds me to account. It's Matthew chapter 5, verse 48. It says, "Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." You know, and that's it's definitely not my favorite verse because it's just really hard to be perfect, I'm finding. But it is definitely something that kind of holds me to account. You know, my parents obviously were Christians from the time I was born. So I was always in church. I was always in church attending. When I was about 5 or 6, we moved here to Montana, and they were helping out at the youth center over in Victor that was there for a little while. And Dad was giving a message on salvation and the need for Christ in our lives. And that night, you know, it's something about the way he talked and something about what he was saying. You know, I was pretty young. I was 6 or 7 at the time. And, you know, something that he said made me realize I needed to commit my life to Christ. And that night I did. And I remember waking up the next morning feeling like, oh, man, I have no weight on my shoulders. I was only 6, so I don't know what exactly the weight was lifted off. But there was definitely something. And something had changed that day. So that was where I kind of point to my starting relationship with taking my walk with Christ seriously. It was kind of a... my nose keeps turning off, sorry. It's kind of a... I just think it's interesting. You know, we were here in the valley. It was good. We were around a lot of Christians. We hung out. I had a lot of Christian friends. And it was, you know, it was a good time to grow in my life, I guess you could say. My knowledge of the scriptures grew. But we moved to Houston, and that was kind of a dark time for me personally. Because, one, when we moved to Houston, I kind of, as far as in the public life, I kind of closed up. Which is kind of weird. I know for most of you who know me, I'm a very talkative person. I'm very outgoing. But in public life, specifically in like school and stuff like that, I said probably 20 words outside of class the entire time I was in school down in Houston. I was not a very talkative person. I wasn't outreaching. And looking at, I can see times where, you know, God actually put people in my life that needed him. And, you know, I can see opportunities wasted. And that's where this verse is not my favorite verse because I really want to be perfect. And obviously, God has grace for that. But the Houston for me was a dark time. because I was not really serious about my faith. And I actually showed when we moved back to Montana, I just kind of assumed that everything was going to be better because we were back to hang out with good friends and everything would be good. It didn't really change. I didn't really change my attitude towards my relationship. I didn't take it seriously. Yeah, I read the Bible every now and then. I prayed every now and then. But I wasn't, you know, I wasn't at school when I didn't talk. I was a foul mouth outside of school and I talked about inappropriate things. And it was just, you know, I did not take my walk with Christ seriously. And actually, it wasn't until right before I started college that all of a sudden I kind of went through like a mini revival where I started realizing, you know what, I'm ready to go to a place that I knew was going to be rough. And I need to take my faith seriously. I need to start learning more about the Lord. I need to prepare to preach the gospel if necessary. I need to prepare to witness to people. And it was kind of like, well, sweet, this is going to be a good opportunity for me. So I can go up to the university and convert them all to Christianity. You know, this is going to be good. Boy, was I wrong. But we got, and I got to the University of Montana. I wanted to go there to the business school. I was interested in going to business. That was kind of tells you my first intent was not to go to evangelize or be Christian. It was to go to for business schooling. So my mind wasn't quite, I wasn't prepared. I was going to do it if it came up, but we'll see what happens. I get up there and I decide to take a class. It's called Introductory Studies into the New Testament. I think what it was called. I was like, sweet, Bible class at a secular college. This is awesome. So I'm going to go take this class. Ooh, it was not a Bible class. Not a solid class at all. It was basically a liberal university's way of making everything in the New Testament a conspiracy theory. Was all it was. And it was hard because there were things that I went to that place assuming I was going to have to talk to people about Jesus, teach them about Jesus. Say, hey, no, this, you're living your life wrong. This is what Jesus is all about. And I came into that place and got scorched because I realized there were people there that knew far more about my own religious book, if you will, the Bible, than I. They considered just another book to be studied and torn apart. I just considered it something to do every once in a while because I was a Christian. And the professor of that class knew the Old Testament and the New Testament backwards and forwards. He could quote it off the top of his head way better than I ever could. And he knew how to make me doubt. And that was pretty much Satan's purpose for the class. And it was really, all it did was twist everything. And that really, to be perfectly frank, messed me up. Because I had just assumed the Bible was true. I didn't take it on faith. I just assumed. It's two different things. And from then, so it was actually shortly after I took that class, I actually moved to Polson. I worked a store up there for Scott for a couple years. And I could not pick up the Bible and read it without doubting what it said. Even just little passages where the disciples were talking to each other. Okay, my first thought would be like, okay, how could the disciples have twisted this after the fact to make it sound good towards Jesus or make it sound what they wanted? And even when I had those thoughts, I said, no, that's not right, that's not true. The simple fact was that I constantly doubted the word, and I could not read it without doubting myself or what it said. And it was extremely difficult to study the word. And I just went, I didn't want to go to church. I didn't want to read the word. I didn't want to talk about God. I mean, I would. And I don't say that I didn't have faith in God, because I was praying a lot that God would break that. I would be able to read the word again. But I had no foundation anymore. It was all based on the little experiences I had with Christ, which, given that I didn't live for him very well in my teen years, that was not helpful, and what the support of my family, essentially. And that was really helping. Thankfully, before I had left, as I was going through that class, I was actually just started attending the brothers' meeting over at the, every Thursday night. And that was a fantastic place, because if they brought up a question, I could try it and get an answer there. So it was kind of nice having the support of the brothers there, but I still, it didn't do anything for me giving the mind cramps, if you will, every time I read the scriptures. And it actually wasn't until we moved back here that I actually got back involved at the brothers' meeting again. And actually, basically, I was forced to read the Bible every time there, because they would sit down and read it. And it took consistent prayer from both my family members and specifically myself. I know my wife was praying a ton for me, too, to where I could actually sit down and do it. It kind of came to a crux Easter, I think three or four years ago now, and to where I actually sat down and I said, that morning I'm going to sit down and I'm going to read all four of the resurrection stories, which is a task in and of itself because they're different from each other in little ways and sometimes in big ways. So if you already have problems with scripture, that's a tough place to go to. But I sat down and I read through it and I prayed all over the place like, God, I don't understand this, I'm having problems with getting this, and then I just kept reading and reading it, and it finally got to the point where actually at the end of the day I could read it without feeling that struggle of doubt there. Which was fantastic, because I could really get back into the Word there. It was shortly after that that God kind of taught me, it was about a year or two after that, God kind of taught me a faith lesson. And the reason I needed the faith lesson, obviously, was to strengthen with the doubt. But I kind of replaced apologetics with my faith. And my faith was growing in Christ because I had the Word again. But I was so concerned about learning. For those of you who don't know, apologetics is kind of studying how to give an answer to someone. Someone says something about Scripture, like how to prove that Jesus rose from the grave. You would give an answer. It's called an apologetic. You're not apologizing for anything. You're just giving an answer based on the Scripture in defense of the faith. Well, I got to the point where I was spending way more time reading apologetics books and studying those than I was reading the Word. So it was kind of flipped the other way. I was more concerned about giving an answer than I was actually reading the answer. And it was, you know, I kind of got to the point where my faith was growing and I was more secure. But if ever an incident came up where I feel like I couldn't give an answer, my first response was not to remember my reliance on God and my faith in Jesus Christ, but it was always to, let's go find the answer. Because if I can't find an answer, ultimately, I have a problem. I don't have faith. So I have to have an answer in order to have faith. And I think it was where I was driving down, I'm pretty sure I was driving down the road going to my parents' house. And for some reason, I was alone, so I must have been coming after work or something. And I remember having this almost like this idea or this vision, whatever you want to call it, of, felt like God was telling me, if your mom told you to go to the store and get some bread, you wouldn't doubt why she told you to get the bread. You would not doubt her intent. Ultimately, you could only think that whatever her intent with the bread was, it would be good. Because of your faith in your mother. Because of your trust in your mother. And he said, basically, this is what I want you to do with me. Is trust my intent, trust my heart. And that was a big moment in my life. Because what is it with public speaking and crying? I swear I wasn't going to cry, but apparently I am. So anyway, because it was a point where I realized the faith wasn't the faith in the answers, it was the faith in who the person was. And that really rocked my world that day. It's just like, whoa, I understand now. All the apologetic stuff is perfectly fine and acceptable and good to have, because it's helped me help the youth group a ton. But knowing, you know, the extent of the faith in our God is amazing. So anyway, so basically, since then, you know, it's actually after that that this verse kind of really started popping in my head more frequently. Be perfect, therefore, as your Heavenly Father is perfect. Because I keep finding out that I'm not. You know, before I thought I was so naive going to college. I mean, it was so naive. Thing. I remember my mother saying one time, I said, I can go up there, I was telling her, I can go up there and I can preach to the homosexuals and I can teach them about Jesus. And my mom was like, are you sure? You better be prepared because this is not something that's going to be easy. I was like, oh, I know, I'll read the Bible, I'll make sure I got it down. You know, I never once met a homosexual up there as far as I'm aware. I spent more time, you know, playing my computer game or anything else. I didn't take it seriously. It was not good. But, you know, the thing I'm finding out, you know, is I struggled with a lot of things, and it seems like when God gets you over one thing, he brings up another thing to figure out. Like for me right now, this thing I'm struggling with, the other day, I was talking to Kayla, and I was like, you know, I'm a pretty nice guy. I'm in my pride, I guess you could say. I'm a pretty nice guy. I don't find myself as an angry person. She went, I was like, you think I'm an angry person? She's like, well, it's like, do you think I have anger issues? She's like, well, I was like, I'm not an angry person. And then she's like, well, I don't think you're, now, I would, well, and then she wouldn't say anything after that, and I was like, I have anger issues. So I asked Dad, and I said, do you think I'm an angry person? I asked Benjamin, too, and they were like, Dad's like, sometimes. And was like, here I am thinking I'm a good person, and I'm not angry or anything like that. Apparently, I am. And it didn't really come up until this whole diabetes thing kicked in, because that part of the high sugar thing is, I found out, you know, it really has a tendency. If I have a high sugar, it's really hard for me to control my temper. I didn't think I had a temper until I became a diabetic, and then I realized, holy cow. And actually, I have a whole lot of grace for my father, because when I was much younger, I would see him just be in these moods where it's like, what's wrong with him? Why is he so cranky and angry at everything? Now I know. His sugar was high, and everything makes you angry. You just want to crush things. So that's kind of where I was thinking. I just assumed, you know, I said, well, my wife knows this because of my diabetes thing. Apparently, we've been married for 6 years almost. She said, no, we've had anger issues since I married you. Wow, that's kind of humbling. So, you know, that's kind of what, you know, one of those things where it seems like God is really, and he's been working with me now. My wife has even been saying, hey, good job, you haven't been so angry lately. I was like, back to where I thought I was. That's fantastic. But, you know, it's a constant changeover to what he was. My salvation, my testimony, whatever you want to say, wasn't an instantaneous change from the scum to over to the brand new perfect being. It's been a slow work. And that's why it's not a sprint. It's a long endurance race. And it's, you know, and the more I get to know Jesus, the more I dislike my flesh. The more I realize how much crap I have in my life that I don't want there anymore. And it's just like, man, I'm so thankful, one, that he will get me through it, because he's the only reason I'm sustaining and actually able to deal with all the junk in my life. But it's, yeah, I mean, having Christ has been, well, obviously, one of the best things that ever happened in my life. It's also one of the hardest things, because it's hard to change your natural self. Because your natural self doesn't want to go. And it has to be cut out. So, anyway, that's my self-testimony, and hand it back over to you.
You guys don't know what kind of risks I take having my children get up. I have no idea what parts of me they're going to reveal to you. So, we are in Colossians chapter 3, rolling along. I'm going to not do something that last week I kind of indicated that I might. I have really been struggling for about 2.5 weeks on the issue of predestination and how to present it and to discuss it. And not really even what to say, because I know what I believe. But I've been very convicted about making the minors majors. And I think that's a minor. This is, you know, whether you believe that God chose you with or without your will is irrelevant to whether or not you're going to heaven. Okay, it's of no consequence. You know, I always use the example of the minors being, you know, eschatology. You know, it, quite honestly, it doesn't matter whether you believe pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib. What matters is you believe he's coming back. And we get so caught up in pre, mid, post, and pre, on, post, and all these other things that we tend to neglect the fact that our great hope is his return. You know, the one that we have hope in is coming back to claim his own. And so I was praying earlier this week, and on Tuesday I was really struggling, because I felt like dealing with predestination would potentially become a divisive issue. Now, if there are some of you that are here that believe in the, you know, the points of Calvinism and high Calvinism, and God bless you. You know, quite honestly, one of these days we will stand before the throne and we'll find out we were all wrong somewhere. Okay? But the point is, we will be standing before the throne. Okay? And I don't want to give any time to divisive issues. Okay? Now, if you want to discuss with me predestination personally, one-on-one, hey, we can have a nice talk. But I'm not going to argue. I'm not going to call it silly. So, I'm not going to go back to God's chosen people. I believe that if you have done what Scripture says in confessing Jesus as your Lord and Savior, believing in your heart, you're saved. Whether you chose it, whether God chose it, whatever, you're saved. You are one of God's chosen ones. And that's all that needs to be said. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, moving forward, now we get to talk about what that looks like. And this is cool. And this is troubling. Kind of like coolly troubling. Because, you know, there is a marked difference between being one of his and being one of the world's. And we have to be able to see that difference. Okay? So, we are in Colossians chapter 3, starting in verse 12. And by the way, I'm still in my intro. Okay? So we're going to intro this, and in the next few weeks, we're actually going to go back and we're going to tear this apart. Because there's a lot of good stuff in here. Okay? So Colossians chapter 3, verse 12, put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these things, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. See, there it is, be thankful again. Okay? Now, last week we kind of got about halfway through this list, and I'm going to kind of back up a little bit, because, you know, these are character attributes of a Christian. Okay? And this is really, passages like this are very troubling to me. Because I fail to measure up so much. And I was preparing a message, and I always kind of bounce things off of Christy. Because I feel like it's always good to get another view, another input. A lot of times I bounce things off of you guys and you don't even know. And so if you ever hear me quote you up here and I don't give you credit, forgive me. Okay? But I, you know, when I'm just kind of trying to get another view of things, because I know I'm limited in my scope, I'm limited in my experience, I'm limited in my intelligence, and it helps to get some other views. And she brought up a really good point that I'm going to share with you in a minute. But really right here, what we're talking about is fruit. Okay? Flip over with me, if you would, to Galatians chapter 5. Now, interestingly enough, the fruit of the Spirit is always contrasted with the works of the flesh. Okay? And this is how we as Christians are able to tell who are of which group. You know, Jesus calls them the sheep and the goats. Okay? Or the fruit and the thorns. And so we're talking about fruit today, so leave the sheep and the goats for later. We'll deal with animal husbandry later. But we're talking about fruit, and in Galatians chapter 5, Paul is going through and he lists all, well, he doesn't list all the works of the flesh. This is not a comprehensive list. It's an indicative list. It gives you indications of what the works of the flesh are. Okay? But going down, he says in verse 22, Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, but, because it's a contrast, he's not turning the page. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now, I'm gonna address another passage here in just a minute that talks about more fruit. Okay. But if these are characteristics of those who are led by God's Spirit, you know, see, at the moment of salvation, you are sealed how?
With the Holy Spirit.
With the Holy Spirit. You become one of His, wham, you get the Holy Spirit. And that's God's stamp all over you saying, this is mine. Okay? So, when you have God's Spirit living in you, these are the things that flow out of that. Now, unfortunately, sometimes it takes a little while to open the spigot to get them flowing. You know, I've got some of these that I think my spigot's rusted. And God sometimes takes a hammer and bangs on them a little bit and says, God, work on patience. God, not now. I got things to do. So, these are things that should be flowing out of you. And in all of my studies and all of my pulling notes together and looking at different things, one of the things that I completely overlooked that Christy kind of shared with me. Now, you understand that this is a problem. Because, see, this is the life that you're supposed to be living. This is supposed to be what's pouring out of you. All right? Now, be honest with yourself and kind of take a quick measure of these things. Keeping in mind that you're not measuring yourself against me, so you don't get to feel good about how well you're doing. You're measuring yourself up against Christ. That's the standard to which we're called. Okay, so automatically, every one of you flunked. No, I'm not, we didn't flunk. The idea is that we're going to be increasing in these things, okay? So I want you to look and be honest with yourself. Verse 22, I'm going to read it again. The fruit of the Spirit is love. How are you doing in that department? How's that going for you? Okay? How is your love for those people that have offended you and hurt you? How is your love? I mean, yeah, it's great to say, yeah, I love my wife. How are you treating with her? Because see, love is not based on just a feeling. You know that, what is it, DC Talk has that song, Love is a Verb? It's because it's an action. You know, if you say you love your wife, but never in your life actually do anything to prove that love, how long do you think she's going to believe you? Not long. Okay, but let's go beyond that. We'll deal with our kids. We love our kids because we have to. That's not true. But I know a lot of people, man, the way they treat their kids, I can't figure out there's any love in there at all. On both ends of the spectrum. I've seen some that completely abandon their kids, and you think, what? You're living in the same house, but you're not a family. And I've seen others that give their kids everything they want except for what they need. A good swift kick in the behind. So just because you're not being abusive to them does not necessarily mean you're loving them, okay? Let's go beyond that. How about the people that you work with? How's your love holding up under that? How's the measure there? Okay, so we kind of get the picture that this love that is supposed to be radiating out from us in the measure that Christ had, okay? In the measure that Christ had. So now we go, joy. That's one where my spigots broke. One of the things that I hate when people tell me is, it's going to be fun. I don't care. Very few things in this life do I look forward to being fun. Okay, I just don't care. And my poor wife, she likes fun. She married me. So pray for me, okay? Because my wife also likes spontaneity, and I don't think I've ever been spontaneous in my life. But joy, you know, joy is a fruit of God's Spirit. I'm not talking about happiness, okay? Although the two can look very similar. Because joy is consistent as an outgrowth of your life, not based on what's going on in your life, okay? Yay, I'm happy, I've got a raise today. Yeah, and as soon as you go out and incur a new bill that's going to eat up that raise, your happiness just goes away. Okay. Joy is consistent throughout. Okay. Because joy is not based on what you're doing or what's going on. It's based on who you know, who's inside of you. Okay. So joy. Peace. I guess I got peace when people leave me alone. I mean, really, peace is easy to have if everything goes well. You know, there's a story, there was a contest years ago. There was a large sum of money put up, and they asked artists to paint a picture that would be indicative of peace. And there were three that made the final. And the first one was by a very famous artist. It was a beautiful seascape. And you could just see the rollers coming in. It's nice and gentle. And there's a beautiful sunset in the background. Absolutely gorgeous picture. You know, it's like one of those things when, and I'm not a beach person. I mean, I was born in San Diego and I remember going to the beach. But I don't care if I ever go back. But I know there are people here that are beach people that love just sitting in the sand and the sun shining on you and the sound of the water. That makes me have to go to the bathroom. But I know there's people that like that. And this picture was just like the ideal picture for that. And it just kind of radiated peace. Well, the second one, which was much more into my liking, was a beautiful mountain set. Okay, a mountain scene, and there's a little stream coming down, and off to the side you can see a deer kind of over in the thicket, and it's just a beautiful, peaceful thing. Colors are starting to change into fall. Just a gorgeous painting. Okay, and that would suit me much more. Okay, but the third one people thought was a little bit odd to be in this picture of paintings for peace, because it was a picture of an old lady sitting in a rocking chair with her Bible spread on her knees. Okay, and all around her were pictures of horrible, horrible calamities. Pictures of war and pictures of earthquakes and people fighting and just horrible things. But see, that one actually won the prize. Because see, you can enjoy peace when there's nothing to bother you. But if you can enjoy peace when all of that is going on around you, then you have indeed peace. Okay? And that's the kind of peace that we are called to. In that moment, when the calamities are going on around us, we should have peace. So peace. Patience. We talked about this last week. I'm scoring myself really low on that. Okay. Higher than I was a few years ago. Mostly because I don't have the energy to extend in being angry all the time. Okay, and because I got my sugars down. So, patience, kindness. You know, in a society that kind of encourages and idolizes briskness and being to the point and not dilly-dallying around with a lot of emotionalism, you know, we have things like Donald Trump and his TV show, The Apprentice, and we have shows where, you know, the survivor, where the one that actually wins is the one that is the best at cutting everybody's throat. We don't really think a lot about being kind, okay? It's just one of those things that has fallen away. And I'm afraid in the church it also has fallen away. It's been minimized in its importance and its value. Okay? That's something that, again, I guess I have to score myself pretty low on. Goodness. That could go a bunch of different ways. Goodness. Are you a good person? Well, let's see. If we go by our actions, I could probably be considered a very good person. I've never killed anyone. Never really seriously maimed anyone. Christopher's got some neck issues from when I dropped him, but that was an accident. But see, the measure isn't necessarily what comes out of our bodies, but it's what's inside of our bodies. What are you thinking about those people? You know, what are you thinking about those situations? Are you a good person inside, not just by what you let to the outside? Faithfulness. To who? To who? Gentleness. See, this one kind of goes with kindness. We've kind of lost the value of gentleness. You know? That doesn't mean soft. It doesn't mean soft. It means gentle. Now, you know, we have guys that have enormous strength that are very, very gentle. So it has nothing to do with being weak. It has to do with consciously choosing to not exert your strength. Okay? Self-control. There's another one to trust in. Self-control. We're all lacking in that to some degree. Okay, some of us more, some of us less. But again, it's not just what you do, it's what rages inside. What goes on up here in the noggin. Okay, self-control. Do you control your thoughts? Do you realize we're called to control our thoughts? That we're not allowed, we're not supposed to just let them run rampant? God says, no, don't think about those things. Philippians tells us what we are supposed to think about. Philippians chapter 4. And in several places it tells us, you know, hey, we have to have the mind of Christ. How can you have the mind of Christ if you don't know what the mind of Christ is? It tells us don't put your mind on things of this earth. Put your mind on things above. Okay? We are called to be different. Self-control. Are we exerting self-control? Now, I've laid before you the dilemma because, you know, on our scorecard, measuring against the perfect 100% that Jesus is, you know, I think all of us are not doing so well. And that's the dilemma. But, you know, here's the cool thing. Because he hasn't just given us a dilemma without giving us an answer. And this was the thing that Christy kind of revealed to me last night when she and I were talking about it. It was just one of those things that I don't know why I didn't think of it. I knew it. When she said it, it wasn't like it was something that was new and surprising. It was just something that had kind of missed coming into my head. How do we exhibit those things? Well, when we are saved, we are sealed with God's Spirit, right? Now let's go back and read a little bit more in Galatians. I lost my place. Oh, I'm backing up. Okay, I'm going to back up a little bit. Okay, because here he gave the answer first. Verse 16. He says, "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh." Now, here's the thing that is so cool about this. You realize you can't do this on your own, right? That's religion. Oh, I gotta do better self-control, darn it! Well, you blew it again. No, but I want to be in self-control right now. You just ruined patience, too. And peace, because, you know, you didn't just blow one of them. You blew a lot of them. That's religion. That's your attempt to please God. Okay? We need to understand that God has not called us to a place that he has not prepared us to go. Right? Right? Okay? That's the whole point of the cross. When God says, be perfect as I am perfect, be holy as I am holy, if he left it at that, not a one of us would ever impress God. Not a one of us would ever please God. Why? Because we're incapable. We can't be perfect on our own. We can do some good things. We can have some good thoughts, you know. And occasionally we even get things right. And then we go, yes! And you totally blew it because you just got proud of what you did right. Okay? But he didn't just end it there. Because we have a righteousness that is not our own. We have a perfection that is not our own. Right? God tells us in his word that he has forever made perfect those who are being made holy, right? How are we made perfect? The cross. The cross. It's not your perfection. Okay? It's not your perfection. So, if it's not your perfection, then neither are any of these your fruit. Do you understand that? Okay? It's not called the fruit of Glenn. You might get like a raisin. Shriveled on the vine. Okay? Neither is it called the fruit of you. It's called the fruit of the Spirit. Okay? So, our trick isn't to make these things happen. Our trick is to get out of the way. To quit impeding those things from happening. We have to live a life led by God's Spirit. Now, I am not talking about getting to the four-way stop down here and asking God, which way do I turn? I'm not talking about being immobilized. I'm talking about being submitted to what he desires of you. Now, how many of you scored yourself on a, let's just say, how many of you scored yourself a C? Because I'll tell you right now, I got a D minus. I'm serious. When I went through and I started looking at these things, because I see such huge areas of improvement that need to take place. But the cool thing about this is I'm at least at a point now where I see that I need the improvement. Because a few years ago, I didn't. I thought I had it all together. Man, I go to church, I teach Sunday school, I've been in youth group, I'm on the leadership team, and God was not impressed. Okay? Just because you can restrain yourself from putting those things out there doesn't mean they're not going on in here. Going on in here. Going on in here. You know, in the Hebrew, the heart wasn't the center of emotion, it was the belly. I got a lot of emotion. I do. You know. But if we are to, you know, looking back, I realize now how much further I've got to go. And that could be overwhelming. And I don't want you to be overwhelming, because we're going to jump ahead to 2 Peter. If you would turn with me to 2 Peter. I'm going to start in verse 3. Second Peter, verse 3, chapter 1, verse 3, says, His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of Him who called us to His own glory and excellence. Okay, so see, this should be, I want this passage to be encouraging to you, because right here, He already tells us everything that you need to accomplish what needs to be accomplished has been given you. Everything you need. Okay? You have to believe that. If you don't believe that, you've eliminated part of God's Word, and how can you believe that you have salvation? When you start taking parts out of God's Word, how can you believe any of it? If some of it is subject to your understanding and your ability to agree with, and you disagree with it, so you pull it out, how do you know that what is left is true? Okay? You have to believe that God has given us everything we need. Now, a lot of times we prevent it from happening, but it's there. Okay? So, going on. By which He granted to us His precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. Now, I've read that because of what's coming next. For this very reason. What reason? Because of what He's given us. Because of what He's done for us. This reason, because of this, make every effort to supplement your faith with virtue. And with virtue, with knowledge. And knowledge, with self-control. And self-control, with steadfastness. And steadfastness, with godliness. And godliness, with brotherly affection. And brotherly affection, with love. For if these qualities are yours and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, the fruit isn't just there so we look different. It's there so we can be effective. The characteristics, the attributes of a Christian, yeah, they mark us different. They mark us separate. They mark us holy. Right? Remember, what is our definition of holy? Called out ones, separate ones, ones that are not like the profane, the common. We're uncommon. We're unique. We're weird. Okay? In the eyes of this world, we should be weird. Because the carnal man, the carnal mind, cannot understand spiritual things. When I don't understand something, I go, that's weird. Right? You know, I worked for a while with an electrician, and he showed me the one thing, and this is why I can never be an electrician. He said, the one thing you have to know as an electrician is how to wire a double switch, what you need to do, and how it works. If you can figure that out, you can do anything as far as an electrician. I can't. I see what he did, and it makes no sense to me. All right? I can do it, but it makes no sense to me. And I do it, and it's like, well, this one turns it on, and that one turns it off, but that one doesn't turn it back on. I have to go back up to this one. Okay? It doesn't make sense to me. The carnal mind is the same way. Okay? thing. When it looks at us, when it looks at us and it says, what is all this God stuff? Why in the world Sunday, man? That's it. You only get 2 days to sleep in. Why would you give up Sunday to sleep in? So that you can go and hang out with people and sing songs and sit in chairs and listen to a guy talk. They don't get it. Okay? Why would you not cheat on your taxes? I mean, nobody's going to catch you. Why would you not do these things? What's wrong with a little of this and a little of that? Okay? We should be different. The fruit marks us as being different. Now look, you can be different by being legalistic and being the law. But really, who wants any of that? Really? Westboro Baptist Church. You know their attendance has not increased in years, except through childbirth. Why? Because what are they offering? Hate. Condemnation. Law. Legalism. That nobody wants that. Fruit. I mean, really. When things are going crazy at work, and you have peace, and you're not getting irate and frustrated and throwing things around or letting slip the F-bomb, you think that's noticed? Yeah, it's noticed. It's noticed. Okay? When in the midst of that you have joy, you think people notice? They notice. So it's there to mark us, but there's also something here that it says, for if these qualities are yours, verse 8, and are increasing, they keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. See, this is another way we come to know Jesus. We grow in knowledge of Him. Okay? It's this weird dynamic that God gives us His Spirit. His Spirit births in us fruit. The fruit births in us a more intimate knowledge of the One who sent His Spirit to save us in the first place. You see that? See, the thing about this is this is giving you an answer for the lack that you may be having. Okay? The dilemma. See, I don't have to live the rest of my life with a D-. And I don't have to do anything except get out of the way to be increasing my grade point average here. If I let God's Spirit do as God will in me, shouldn't, by definition of what we just read, I be increasing? Shouldn't I be increasing? Shouldn't I have more joy a year from now than I have today? See, if I don't, then what happened? I'm the one that stifled God's Spirit in my life. I'm going to read a little bit further here. In verse 9. For whoever lacks these qualities is so nearsighted that he is blind, having forgotten that he was cleansed from his former sins. Therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election, for if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. For in this way, there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, we don't... Who here wants to be blind? Really? But we don't give thought to the life that we are given, the spiritual being that we are. You know, the rebirth, the spiritual birth, where we start off as infants. See, it's not enough to just be born. You have to grow. You have to mature. You know, and that doesn't just come with chronology. It doesn't just come with the passage of time. Because I know people that have been saved for 25, 30, 35 years that are still mewling babes. And there's never been growth. And I don't know about you, but seeing a 35-year-old infant is disgusting. Okay? We are called to more than this. And it's not... Look, I don't want you to feel like I'm putting a burden on you. Because the burden isn't on you. The burden is on God's Spirit in you to do these things. Will you let Him do these things? Will you? Will you allow him to make you markedly different than the world? Beyond just going to church. Beyond just having a Bible, and then some, for in some cases, reading your Bible. Beyond occasionally having prayer time. Now, all of those things are good and valuable, and in increasing measure, even more so. But will you allow him to make you different? Because that comes with great risk. Okay? Because once you are identified as his, you're marked. You're a marked man. Okay? Because if Satan can keep you, what does he say here? Ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's already won a great victory. Now notice he doesn't say you're not saved. He just says you're immature, you're babies. You need to grow up. Okay. But he's won a great victory because he's prevented you from causing any more damage to his kingdom in this life. Right? You understand we're at war. Okay? Being a Christian is not for sissies. Okay? Because when you're a Christian, you've set yourself in opposition to the world system and the ruler thereof. And he hates you. And you are at war. Now, you want to go into war wearing your little diaper and your little burp rag. You're in trouble. Those things don't provide a lot of protection. But if you want to take on the full armor of God, which we're called to do, to bear, and make a difference, you have to be marked, you have to be sealed. As a Christian, you are. Dunk. That's mine. And you have to get out of his way so he can do in you what he wants. Growth. Maturity. Now, it's kind of weird that maturity would come about as being listed in these fruits. But I'll tell you what, the more those fruits are present in your life, the more mature you are. Because you're not going to be making snap decisions out of emotional anger or an outburst, because you're going to be having peace. And you're going to have patience. And you're going to be able to take a step back. And above all these things, you're going to have love. You're going to put on love. The agape love. That when Jesus was in the garden and he knew what was coming, he willingly laid it down. Did he want to go to the cross? Absolutely. No, yes. Because that 100% man part of him, he didn't want to be scourged. He didn't want to be beaten. He didn't want to be nailed to the cross. But that 100% God of him knew that was the cost, knew that was the price, knew that was what was necessary. Therefore, in the garden, he says, God, if there is any other way, take this cup from me. But, now see, that's where we often end our prayer. God, if there's any other way, take it away. And he says, but, not my will, but yours be done. Okay? That's where the rubber meets the road. That's where we've got to be. And that's what I'm talking about right here. Are you willing to take up the mantle of a Christian, to allow God's Spirit to work in you as he wills, what he wills, such that his fruit will be evident in your life? And in the interplay, interaction that you have with those in this body and those out there in the world. Are you willing that in several months' time, several years' time, these fruits are more evident to those around you? And even in measure to yourself. You know, oftentimes we don't see it in ourselves. Other people see it in us. You know, Christy made a comment a few days ago, we were talking, and she was talking about some of the changes that God had wrought in me. And I guess if I look back in measure, I see those things having happened, but I don't really notice it because I'm still struggling with this person that I drag around called me. And so sometimes it's kind of an encouragement when she goes, yeah, I can't believe the changes that God is bringing about in you. So are you willing, months down the road, years down the road, to have allowed that change to take place so that you might know him more? So that you might be more effective. Are you willing? All it takes is getting out of the way. Getting out of the way. Okay? Now, you know, it would be great to say, oh, just, you know, being a Christian, that's all there is to it. Well, it kind of is. You know, it kind of is. Because as you grow in his Spirit, those parts of you that are ugly, You know those, the sin part of you that you've been habituated into doing? Those things start to fall away. And you know, Christopher said, you know, it's kind of weird when God deals with one thing and you kind of finally get a handle on it, He reveals something else. Trust me, your supply of something else is inexhaustible. Okay, because there's always more things for Him to bring up. Okay? Because we are not in this life ever going to be perfect. If we were, there would be no need for His perfection to be imputed to us. Okay, that's why, again, we go back to, He is forever made perfect those who are being made holy. We are perfect because of Him. All right? Let Him start working this out in you, making those changes, bringing about in you the very nature of His Spirit. Right? Amen?
Yeah.
Okay, I want you to be encouraged because, yeah, this is a daunting task. If you take it on yourself, you're going to fall. But God has given us everything that we need to accomplish this. Everything that we need. Everything that we need for love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. All of those He's given us. Amen? Now, next week, flip back to Colossians. Just to kind of give you a foretaste of where we're going. We talked about the fruit. Verse 14, chapter 3, says, And above all these, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you are called in one body, and be thankful. We're going to touch on these things. But see, over the next few weeks, we're going to nail these. We're going to get down. We're going to start looking at, what does God mean when He talks about put on love? Tie-dye shirts and VW bugs? Okay. What does He mean when He talks about these things? Now we're going to start getting a working description of what the nature of a Christian should look like. And I think some of these things are going to surprise you. I think by definition they will surprise you, because it's not for wimps. The world has you believe that being a Christian calls you to be wimpy. It doesn't. It calls you to be tough, to be strong, to be firm, to be fixed of purpose. Amen? Mm-hmm. All right.